discover there's not a lot of data that we can use in order to. Gathering the data is hard, and a lot of the time it's because it simply doesn't exist, and when it does exist, it's either really malformed and requires a lot of cleanup and reprocessing, or we're simply not allowed to have our hands on it. It could be proprietary. A lot of corporations have the data, like Google and YouTube, as we'll see later, and it's just not publicly accessible. And when we try to gather it ourselves, we run into the fact that it's a huge time sink, and we either need to have that time or that manpower to collect it. And traceability is another domain of requirements engineering in which it's no exception. We define traceability as the ability to describe all of the lifetime of a requirement. This is both done in a forwards and backwards manner. For example, if we were to follow a single requirement, it would be from its origins, whether that be from the first meeting that you sit down at to an email chain, specifications, more formal stuff that requirement, the development of it, its use, and then any refinements that are made on that. In most research, we attempt to find links between these high-level source requirements and the low-level target requirements. If they're higher up the chain, they're typically considered a source, but down lower towards the implementation, they're targets. For example, we can trace a requirement specification, which is high level, to a design document, which is lower level. So what did we want to do? Well, we had all of these data sets. We didn't have a lot of information on what exactly was contained in them. It'd be nice to have a back of the book summary of what was in them. These data sets contained various artifacts from various projects. We had requirements, both functional and non-functional. We had lower level use cases, and we'll see a few more types as we go on. These assist researchers in knowing which data sets to use. And the data sets are commonly used by the requirements engineering community. We have a collection of them on a website, and we can parse through a few of them to see which ones we wanted to generate metadata on first. There's little information contained, their contents or features. But the domains of these data sets span a wide range of fields, healthcare, business management. We have one that explains a telephone network. These are the six data sets that we started off with. Infusion pump is the requirements and components of a specification for a medical infusion pump. We have CCHXT and World Vista. World Vista is a application that's commonly used in healthcare, and CCHIT are a lot of policies that this application needs to implement. Ant is a project management tool. If you've ever seen a Gantt chart, it shows a timeline of a project and all of the things that need to be done, and all of the things that being done is dependent on being done first. CM1 was a data set that contained requirements for a space science system created by NASA. WARC was a web archive tool. We have the artifacts from that project. And finally, Waterloo was the internet telephone application.
What are non-functional requirements?
Well, functional requirements are a lot more tangible. They're things that the project should do. And non-functional requirements are softer things that it should do. For example, this application should be secure. It should run quickly, be responsive. Yes.
So a non-functional requirement might be for a game, it's got to be fun.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a lot softer. Our functional requirements can be very hard and sensitive. And so for some general statistics as to what these six data sets contain, we have their source artifacts and their target artifacts. Source artifacts can be considered things like regulatory codes, functional requirements, non-functional requirements like we just discussed, and otherwise we just qualify them as high-level requirements. As for low-level requirements, we can see things like design elements and software requirement specifications, as well as use cases. And the links are the number of times we can look at a source artifact and look at the target artifact and say, yes, these two artifacts are related. Those aren't necessarily one-to-one, as you can probably tell by your gut math. Sometimes these source artifacts related to several target artifacts, and generally these target artifacts, or the number of target artifacts, tended to be much greater than the number of source artifacts, which makes sense on an intuitive we wanted to use parts of speech and figure out the number of nouns, verbs, adjectives, etc. We got a little bit finer grained than that. For example, we could find proper nouns, singular, plural, and this was done by the Stanford parser, which we'll look at later. High-level look at readability metrics. These are used to discern how difficult a text is to read and comprehend. It evaluates a text, looks at certain qualities of that text, and gives you a number that represents very softly how difficult it is to read. Most of these equations stem from regression analysis. We can see a few of the equations here. There's very many different types of readability metrics, and none of them is really a silver bullet, but they all do good in certain types of text. Letting K, reading ease, indicates the difficulty of reading a piece of English literature, and non-intuitively, a higher score indicates text that is easier to read. On the other hand, this can be converted to a letting K grade level, which returns a number that shows what grade in American grade school we would need to be in order to hopefully comprehend this text. And finally, we have smog index, which I was asked to figure out what that stood for, and it doesn't really stand for anything. It stands for simple measure of gobbledygook. It estimates the required years for formal education to read, so it's similar to Fletcher at grade level, but not quite. So for the parts of speech, again, we use the Stanford parts of speech tagger. This assigns tags to each word. It's a little bit more fine-grained than what they teach you in elementary school. We have, like I said, proper nouns, different tenses of verbs, different types of adjectives, for example, imperative, superlative adjectives. And we counted, at least at this point in time, simply the number of nouns, pronouns, verbs, and adjectives. We
Which is lucky because it made a mistake on the first words. That's not a conjunction. You're not counting those.
Thank you. I'll fix that later. So these are the metrics that we collected, which I've already discussed. In terms of polysyllables, we use the most popular definition, which is a word containing three or more syllables, not two. And we also collected the percent of polysyllables compared to the total number of words, because we wanted to see how many words, typically longer words hold more meaning. Conjunctions tend to be very short, and this allowed us to see which words, or how much of the text actually contain meaning, and which were words such as A and B and of that don't convey a lot of meaning, but we need them to connect our words to make sense. So for an example of a source artifact, here's one that I pulled from the Gantt higher level requirements. This is requirement two. And all of these requirements were stored in individual text files, and they were snippets from a larger body of text. So they don't necessarily, they might read a little weird in terms of just themselves. For example, delete an existing task and all associated information, such as links to other tasks or knowledge on what resources are supposed to work on them. Okay. Kind of get the gist of what it's trying to say, but maybe some context would have been nice. In terms of the dataset statistics, the high-level requirements as a whole, well, these are the statistics for them, but they'll make a lot of sense when we look at the low-level requirement statistics. Target artifact is, as I said, finer-grained. You can see that it's talking more about specific classes within the project, and you can probably tell a little bit that it's using an object-oriented language, etc. And we can tell exactly how this prior high-level requirement was intended to be implemented. I don't think I chose ones that related exactly to requirement two, but we can get the gist. And for a comparison, we can see, as I said previously, that the target-level requirements tend to be a lot larger. They tend to use more polysyllables, which could be related to the fact that
So I'm curious, did you, specifically with respect to polysyllables, did you find that most of the polysyllables in these requirements documents were things like class names?
Yes, I was literally about to say that. Yeah. We didn't have a good way to sort out class names because one of the approaches that I wanted to use was to read every single word and look it up in a dictionary. And if it wasn't in that dictionary, then we would just ignore it because maybe it was nonsensical. But a lot of the times, there are words that, well, if you've ever typed a Word document, you can probably get a couple sentences in, and the Word will tell you number of polysyllables does tend to be much larger. However, the percent of polysyllables in terms of the grand scheme of the data set as a whole, or that section of the data set, we would consider GAN to be one data set and high and low to be different sections of that data set. The percent of polysyllables did not tend to change.
Why is smog index not applicable for the high level?
Smog index is not applicable because one of the requirements of calculating the smog index is that there are at least 30 sentences available, which the requirements did not have 30 sentences, so we couldn't calculate that and have to use them. The grade level tended to be easier to read for the high level requirements, which also makes sense because lower level details tend to become more complicated, and also the class names probably skew that quite a bit too. The number of words, polysyllables, etc., tended to vary greatly from one domain's data set to another. The minimal number of words was scanned, it was a very small, simple application. And then, of course, the CCHIT data set, which implemented a whole lot of legal healthcare policies, was very verbose. And of course, that reflected in the number of polysyllables. The percent of polysyllables in total words range depended. I can't say if 10 to 20% is meaningful or not. I would have to look at that. I'd say it's greater than I would have expected, but that's yet to be seen. The fleshing grade levels, of course, also vary greatly with the CCHIT low level data set, or the target data set, being the highest at a college level of 13.889, and the Waterloo data set being the lowest, the high level target, or the high level artifacts of Waterloo being the lowest at fourth grade level. The average was an eighth grade and a half level. This is some correlation analysis that was performed on two different pairs of data sets. We compared a healthcare data set to another healthcare data set, and then we compared a healthcare data set to a non-healthcare related data set. And we, of course, got back that the two healthcare related, or the two healthcare data sets were related both in the high level and low level requirements, and also across those data sets. However, what surprised us was that when we looked at the CCHIT data set compared to the GANT data set, that there was about the same level of correlation. So this implies that we really haven't found different types of metadata that well differentiate data sets across domains.
What do you call that again? Total number of words or all of those metrics at once?
Sorry?
What do you correlate?
All of those metrics, the list of all the metrics.
The list of all the metrics, okay.
Metadata.
And what uses we wanted to get out of this metadata after we had collected it was, first of all, we wanted to make it easy for other researchers to go into this library of data sets and have this goal in mind and not have to dig through all of them and waste their time figuring out which data sets would be the most useful for them, or to spend a lot of time using one and then finding out this isn't exactly what I was looking for. For example, if someone was wanting to do sentiment analysis, then they would probably be looking for a data set with a large number of adjectives. Or if they were wanting to look at functional or non-functional requirements, then they would think to maybe find one with a lot of verbs. Finally, we wanted to be able to predict links for data sets with similar metadata. So if we went into a data set and we performed some AI training using something very traditional like a vector space model, and we went and weeded out the links that were correct and the links that were not correct that model had found, then maybe we could merge this with our metadata and use it in finding the links in another data set, which is something that hasn't commonly been able to be done in requirements engineering. Generally, you train a model on a project, and that project's expended, and so that model is useless and it's not very transferable. So, in conclusion, what we were able to do was we found these data sets and we did generate the metadata that I've shown. And we've also published the tools that we used in creating this data. Molly has a Java application that implements or uses the standard parser speech tagger, and I've also written a Python script that reprocesses. processes all of this text and calculates all of the statistics that we found. And finally, we weren't able to find domain-specific features revealed during the preliminary analysis. That doesn't mean that we won't in the future, but at this point in time, we have not. Finally, going into future work, we want to improve our pre-processing techniques. The class names were a very serious problem for us, as well as bulleted lists that we would find in the requirement specifications, incomplete sentences, and a lot of punctuation and stuff that was transferred over from converting a PDF document to a text document caused a lot of issues because sometimes misspellings would arise. We want to further catalog data as we find ways to implement it. The reason that we chose these were that it fits our very narrow specifications for what we were capable of doing now. There were a lot of data sets that were in Italian that reading comprehension scores would not have been applicable because those scores were, or those equations were made for English documents. And finally, we want to discover new sources of metadata and figure out which ones are more useful and which ones are less useful in practice. That's all I have. And
Software and Systems Traceability has a website that posts or provides some of these data sets. Many of them will trace the code, or they might trace to other non-textual artifacts, models, or test cases, and things like that. So simply staying in the requirements vernacular, it's just a subset of those, and then if you want to specifically do tracing, that makes it smaller subset. So some of these things have been used, like you mentioned, non-functional requirements. There's certainly data sets out there where people classify requirements as being either functional or non-functional. And there's data sets out there where people might undertake other activities, which would use artificial intelligence techniques, but undertake other activities for requirements engineering besides tracing. Actually been one of the main generators of data sets and tracing, and not just us, but this Center of Excellence and the people that we've collaborated with on our papers. And I think, as you said, all of this is available from our paper. We posted not only the data sets, the metadata, and also Jared and Molly's tools for generating the metadata.
In total, there was only six or so usable data sets.
So with part of that, and I think you did mention this at the very beginning, maybe on this first or second slide, it's not so much, well, it is partly just finding projects where you can get these artifacts, but it's generating the gold standard or the answer set or the true trace or the oracle or however you want to whatever you want to call it between the different artifacts in order that we can then have our research, because you know, just like when you're doing supervised learning, I guess you need to have your training set, right? So we're really not any different than that. We have had people do sort of quote unquote unsupervised learning in their tracing, and honestly, they're not as well respected as the folks who are doing the research where they're working on these tried and true data sets, where we all now sort of have an understanding about that data set. But I think it's probably the same in the machine learning world too, because right, they really respect these trend data sets and some of these data sets, and now people have a really good idea about that data set and they understand what, oh, these other techniques tend to be in this range for recall and precision and math and so on and so forth, and we're no different in our research community.
Right, so you were asserting yourself to data sets where actually someone has figured out the links between the high and the low level.
Correct.
And that was only one of the many metrics, so you could use very previously datasets where no one has done the linking, and just leave that particular metric off.
That's true.
And there might be a lot more of those.
That, yes. And in our paper, we didn't talk about it here, but in our paper, we did mention that we have a tool now to help people build answer sets and vote on what they believe are truly links between these different artifacts to help, as a community, be able to come up with these answer sets and maybe have more answers, or have more data sets.
I have a very minor question. Could you show the title of your presentation?
Yes.
Yes, so you say here to what improve artificial intelligence for requirements in GDM. But in your conclusion slide, you're saying that this will help researchers in artificial intelligence.
In requirements engineering.
Okay.
Is it so artificial intelligence? What we are